Okay children, we are going to start a new video in rotation dynamics, the dynamics of rigid bodies, and today's topic that we'll be discussing is moment of inertia. So let's write first, moment of inertia, and this will be denoted by I. Now, this term inertia, we are very much familiar with the laws of motion discussed in details. We know that inertia of a body refers to the tendency of a body to remain in its present state of rest or motion. Meaning, the body will offer an opposition if you try to change its present state of rest or motion. Right? So, just like a body has inertia, meaning tendency to oppose any effort to bring about a change in its present state of rest or motion. Similarly, if you want to bring about a change in the rotational state of a body, then again the body has a tendency to oppose it. And this is what we call moment of inertia. Okay? So moment of inertia, what exactly we mean by moment of inertia? Moment of inertia actually is analogous to inertia of a body in rectilinear motion, right? So how will you define a broader term? The broader term will define that moment of inertia of a body, the tendency to remain in its present rotational state or rest. Okay, this is what we call as moment of inertia. So let's write it down. So children, here is moment of inertia. Moment of inertia of a body is tendency of a body to oppose any change in its rotational state of motion. Clear? So it is analogous to inertia of a body in rectilinear motion. So it is just the same thing. Just like a body in the state of rest or motion, it will continue to be so. Similarly, a body in the state of rest or rotational motion, it has a tendency to continue to be so. And if you apply any effort to change it, it will oppose it. This is what is moment of inertia. Let's try to understand what exactly the numerical value of moment of inertia. Let's understand. Suppose this is an axis. You know that for rotating a body, we need to pivot the body. Simply applying force will not. We need to pivot a body and then we need to apply a force, a rotational effect. Suppose there is a mass here, point mass m, located at a distance r from the axis, then moment of inertia of this point mass is equal to the product of mass and square of the distance from the axis of rotation. So moment of inertia of point mass is equal to what? Product of mass and square of distance. Remember, when we did inertia of a particle in laws of motion, we did not have a numerical value for inertia to calculate. But here, we have a numerical value. Moment of inertia of point mass is equal to product of mass and square of distance between the axis of rotation and the given mass. So let's define it. From the axis of rotation, here you define the children. Moment of inertia of a point mass is equal to product of its mass and square of its distance from the axis of rotation. So suppose the mass is m and the distance is r, then moment of inertia, mi, that is I the symbol, is equal to mass into distance squared. So I will be equal to m into r squared, right? Now this mr square is actually the moment of inertia of a point mass. The unit will be kilogram meter square or centimeter gram centimeter square. And moment of inertia actually is also a scalar quantity. So you can just expect this as a number, it is no vector form. So moment of inertia is basically analogous to inertia of a body in rectilinear motion. And how much is numerical value? I is equal to m into r square. Obviously, moment and inertia will depend upon mass. If the mass is more, then inertia will be what? More. and if the resistance is more, then also the moment of inertia will be more. Clear? Now we'll understand the origin of moment of inertia. Actually, children, this inertia is inherent tendency of a body to oppose any change in its present state, right? If it is rectilinear motion, it is simply inertia. If it is rotational motion, it is moment of inertia. Clear? Now we'll try to understand this moment of inertia from the energy equation of a rotating body. Okay? Let's understand how we are getting this term mr square. Let's understand it. Suppose there is an extended body, and this body is rotating about a certain axis. Now this is an extended body. So this body basically is made up of what? A system of particles. So imagine, I'll select a few particles. There's a particle m1 at what distance? R1. Now there's a particle m2 at what distance? R2. There's a particle of mass m3 at distance R3, and I'll go on assuming there'll be infinite number of particles. I'll take another particle mn at a distance rn from the axis of rotation, and I will imagine that the body as a whole is rotating about, this is the axis, with angular velocity what? Omega. And in rotational motion, you know that each particle has same angular velocity as the body itself, but linear velocity of each body is what? Different. Clear? We discussed this concept when we started this chapter, rotational motion. There we said, if a body is rotating, then each and every particle on the body will have the same angular velocity, but different linear velocity, if you remember this. So let's see, the object is undergoing a purely rotational motion. Let an object is undergoing rotational motion with angular velocity omega. Clear? Now when suddenly each particle got same energy, anyway the first particle v1 children will be r1 into omega, v2 will be how much children? R2 into omega, and similarly if another particle vn will be how much? Rn into omega. Therefore, kinetic energy of the body, and you know energy is a scalar quantity which can be added like numbers. So kinetic energy K will be equal to children, kinetic energy first particle plus second particle, and will go on up to the what? Last particle, right? Now kinetic energy of the first particle is half m1 into v1 square, right? Half m2 into v2 square, and the last will be half mn into vn square. Now I'll put in the values. We know v1 is equal to r1 omega, v2 is equal to r2 omega, and vn is equal to rn omega. If I put all these values, so k will be half m1 into r1 omega square plus half m2 into r2 omega square, and lastly we'll get what? Half mn into rn into omega square. Now if you simplify, then kinetic energy K will be equal to children half m1 r1 square omega square plus half m2 r2 square omega square, and lastly it will be half mn rn omega square. So you can see in all these terms omega square is common. So we write therefore K is equal to half m1 r1 square plus half m2 r2 square plus half mn rn square, and the whole thing is multiplied by what? Omega square. Clear? Now these terms that I have written in the bracket can be written as k into sigma half mr square into omega square. Now we come to a very important term here. This is total kinetic energy of the rotating body, and then if we consider the kinetic energy equation is something like what? Half mv square. If a body is undergoing a a rectilinear motion, then how much kinetic energy? Half m into v square. So we can see that omega square is analogous to what? V square. And m is analogous to half mr square. So this term half mr square which you are getting is in fact what? Moment of inertia. So this equation can also be summed up as k is equal to half I into omega square. So it becomes easier to understand now. The sigma I that I'm denoting is in fact sum of all the moment of inertia, and this is where the concept of moment of inertia comes to mind, that half mr square is same as what? Half m. Right? That means what is mass for linear motion is same as moment of inertia for rotational motion. So get in your mind that for a given particle, moment of inertia is half mass into distance square from the axis of rotation. And this formula is very significant, that if we are dealing with an extended object which is made up of a system of particles, then the total moment of inertia of the body will be equal to sum of moment of inertia of individual particles, means moment of inertia of m1 plus m2 plus m3 plus m4 will go until I add up for the last particle. Okay, it is clear. So we'll be framing the statement for moment of inertia for a system of particles. Now let's write that. Moment of inertia of particles. So here we come across a very important conclusion, that moment of inertia of a system of particles is equal to sum of moment of inertia of individual particles. Clear? That means for a system of particles, we have I is equal to I1 plus I2 up to IN. We have to add all these terms. I is equal to M1 R1 square plus M2 R2 square plus Mn Rn square. Clear? Or I is equal to, we have sigma Mr square. Clear? Now, if these particles are given as what? If this is a discrete distribution of particles, where your point masses, which are make up the whole matter, then we can use this. Okay? However, suppose we have uniform distribution of matter like this throughout an axis, and the matter is what? Uniformly distributed. In this case, I'll be using calculus. I'll consider a stripe. A distance what? R square. And I'll assume that the whole body is made up of what? A number of fine stripes, no? Like one stripe is here, and the stripe could be here, and that could be here. And these stripes added will make up the whole matter. Clear? And I'll consider the thickness of the stripe is what? Dr. And as this stripe is very thin, then the mass will also be very small. So what I'll do is, I'll calculate mass of the stripe, that is dm, and then I'll multiply with r square. So I'll get moment of inertia of the stripe will be di is equal to r square into what? Dm. And if I add to the moment of inertia of all the stripes, I'll get the moment of inertia of the what? Whole body, right? So therefore, total moment of inertia, I integrate this sigma r square dm, and this summation is again actually what? Integration. So we get total moment of inertia is equal to r square dm. And then you can set up your limits. So if required, we can use calculus. We can set up suitable limits for r, from R1 to R2, right? R1 is the lower limit and R2 is the upper limit. R1 is the initial distance and R2 could be the what? Final distance, depending on how you choose R to be a variable about this axis. Clear? So if I have to use calculus, moment of inertia, R square dm, and if I have a system of particles where each particle is given as a point mass, compact what? Mass system like we have shown, not like this, but like this, then I can add up the moment of inertia of each individual particle. But remember that moment of inertia is analogous to inertia of motion in rectilinear motion. That's what you have studied in Newton's laws of motion. Clear? Now once you understand this, then the certain terms that you have to understand. One thing is but sure, that moment of inertia is depending upon the what? Choice of the axis. Very important. It's depending on two things: choice of the axis and mass of the body. We cannot alter mass of the body, but we can alter the what? Axis. Like the axis is located here, then R will have one value. If the same axis is located here, R will have another value. If the same axis is located here, R will have another value. So make sure that moment of inertia is not a fixed quantity, depends upon the choice of the axis. However, moment of inertia of a given body about an axis passing through its geometrical center will have a fixed value. Clear? Otherwise, the moment of inertia will depend upon the choice of the axis. Clear? So, let's understand now theorems on moment of inertia. Okay? Theorems on or of moment of inertia. There are two theorems, children, that you have to discuss. First one is called theorem of parallel axis. And number two, theorem of perpendicular axis. Theorem of perpendicular axis. Clear? Theorem of parallel axis and theorem of perpendicular axis. First we will be discussing what is theorem of parallel axis. Theorem of parallel axis. Children, when we are discussing moment of inertia, then we said that moment of inertia of body depends upon the choice of the axis. You can very easily understand. Suppose this is a piece of chalk. I want to rotate it. I fix this axis here. Then I'll find that the object will be offering what? Certain amount of opposition. Now suppose I shift the axis here in the middle and I try to rotate now. Then the opposition will be different. You can feel it actually. So moment of inertia, for example, you're trying to open a door. Right? The door is hinged at one place. And if you try, suppose this is a door, it hinged at this point, is it free to rotate here about this? Pivoted here. If you apply force here and try to rotate, it will be more difficult. I mean the inertia of the object will be different than the one which will be here. Clear? Again it relates to torque also. But the moment of inertia will depend upon what axis of rotation you are choosing. Right? So, first theorem is theorem of parallel axis. Let's understand it. Suppose there is an object here. This is center of the object. And the object is rotating about this axis. And like I told you, that moment of inertia depends upon the choice of the axis. However, moment of inertia of a given object about an axis passing through its center will always have one fixed value. So moment of inertia of this body, suppose about an axis passing through center is ICM. Moment of inertia about center is ICM. But for some reason, I want to calculate moment of inertia of the body about another axis here. Suppose this axis is XY. This axis was EB. EB is the axis which is passing through its what? Center. And about this axis, moment of inertia is ICM. But I want to calculate about another axis, XY, which is not passing through the center, but located somewhere else, but is parallel to which axis? EB. Then how will I calculate? Suppose the distance is how much here? R. And mass of the body is how much here? M. Then the law says that moment of inertia of an object about any axis means let's say it is what? XY axis. मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्सिया ऑफ एन ऑब्जेक्ट अबाउट एनी एक्सिस इज इक्वल टू सम ऑफ मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्सिया अबाउट एन एक्सिस पासिंग थ्रू इट्स सेंटर एंड पैरेलल टू द गिवन एक्सिस, राइट, एंड मास ऑफ प्रोडक्ट ऑफ मास एंड स्क्वायर ऑफ द डिस्टेंस बिटवीन द टू पैरेलल एक्सिस. लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड वंस अगेन. मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्सिया ऑफ एन ऑब्जेक्ट अबाउट एनी गिवन एक्सिस I x y is equal to sum of moment of inertia about any axis, about an axis passing through center, that is I c m, and meaning plus product of mass of the body and square of the distance between the two given parallel axis, so m into r square. So this is the theorem of parallel axis. Let's understand once again. Sum of moment of inertia of an object about any given axis is equal to sum of moment of inertia about an axis passing through its center and mass of the body multiplied by square of distance between the two parallel axes. Clear? Let's write it down. Distance between parallel axis. So this is the theorem of parallel axis. Moment of inertia of a body about any axis is equal to sum of mi means moment of inertia about an axis passing through its center, geometrical center, and product of mass of the body and square of the distance between the two parallel axes. Very simple theorem. Here we have Ixy is equal to ICM plus MR square. I can also write like this. I dash is equal to IC plus MD square, where D the distance between the two given parallel axes. In place of R, you can write what? D also. Depends upon you. Let's see an example for of this. Suppose I have a sphere. The radius of the sphere is R and mass is M. And I want to calculate moment of inertia about any other axis at a distance r by 2. Clear? Now this axis is parallel to what? The axis which is passing through what? Geometrical center. And we know, children, that suppose it is a solid sphere, then moment of inertia about an axis passing through the center is how much of? 2 by 5 mr square. And how much is d in this case? D is equal to how much? R by 2. So if I use, and my task is to calculate moment of inertia of the sphere about the what? New axis. So I will be, children, IC plus MD square. IC is 2 by 5 MR square plus M into how much is D? R by 2 square. Clear? If we simplify, then what do we get? 2 by 5 MR square plus MR square by 4. So what do you get, children? 8 MR square plus 5 MR square by 20. So this moment of inertia I dash is equal to, we have 9 MR square by 20. Clear? So you can easily calculate moment of inertia of an object about any axis which is given, right? This axis may be passing through the center, may be lying inside the body, may be lying what? Outside the body. In all cases, this can be used up. Clear? You only have to ascertain how much is the distance between the two parallel axes. And because of the axis being parallel, we call it theorem of parallel axis. Clear? Now I'll be seeing theorem of perpendicular axis. Okay? Let's see this. Perpendicular axis. What is the theorem of perpendicular axis? Let's understand it. Suppose there is a planar body which is lying in the xy plane. Here you have a planar body which is lying in the xy plane. Clear? Now this body will have a certain moment of inertia about x axis and a certain moment of inertia about y axis. Suppose the moment of inertia along x axis is Ix and about y axis is I y. Then the rule says that moment of inertia of a planar body about an axis perpendicular to the plane of the body, that is, in this case, the body has been kept in what? XY plane. Then the law says that moment of inertia of a body, planar body, about an axis perpendicular to its plane is equal to sum of moment of inertia of the body about the two axes, okay, containing the body. Meaning, the body is contained by which plane? XY plane. So, if moment of inertia about x axis is Ix, about y axis is Iy, then Ix plus Iy will be equal to Iz, because z axis is perpendicular to the plane containing this body. Clear? So, we will be writing the statement of this. The body. Now, children, remember the statement. Moment of inertia of a planar body about an axis perpendicular to the plane of the body is equal to sum of moment of inertia of the body about the axis containing the body. That means z axis is perpendicular plane containing the what? Body. Then I'll be writing here Iz is equal to Ix plus Iy. Clear? So children, these are the theorems we'll be using for many numerical problems as well. So make sure you're understanding it. The theorem of parallel axis and perpendicular axis. If you want to calculate moment of inertia of a body, planar body, about an axis which is perpendicular to the plane of the given body, then it will be equal to sum of the moment of inertia about the two axes which are containing the given body. Clear? So this is the theorem of perpendicular axis. Now children, we'll be deriving moment of inertia for some specific shapes, okay? And then we'll be discussing moment of inertia of more objects, okay? And then we'll come to radius of gyration also of a body, huh? Okay? Moment of inertia of a rod. Here you talk about a rectangular rod, which is, or any rod for that matter. This rod is ready to rotate. Clear? We'll assume that length of the rod is L. The rod is apparently in this case what? Rectangular, cuboidal rod like this. But it can be of any shape. Our discussion will continue to be the same. Understand? This is a rod. We're trying to rotate the rod about two axes. Case one will take about an axis passing through the what? Center of mass, or through its center and perpendicular to the what? Plane of the rod. Rod has been kept like this, and the axis of rotation is perpendicular to this, like this. Okay? Like this. We'll assume that the length of the rod is what? L, and mass is M. Mass is M, children. The length of the rod is L. Clear? So we're going to do moment of inertia of a rod. Case one, about an axis passing through its center and perpendicular to the axis of the rod, that is, this is the rod, this is the axis of the rod, and this is the axis about which it is rotating. Is this clear? So I'm pivoting in the middle, and by pivoting in the middle, I'm rotating like this. This is called about an axis passing through the center and perpendicular to the rod, meaning perpendicular to the axis. This is the axis of the rod. Clear, children? So, for calculating moment of inertia of this rod, I'll consider a stripe here. Like I told you, we'll be using calculus. Because here we can see that the mass distribution is continuous. It is not like point masses. So I'll take a distance x. At a distance x, I'll consider a stripe of thickness dx. Clear? Now the stripe, there'll be very large number of stripes. If I cut this rod into a similar number of stripes and add their masses, it will generate the total mass and also generate the whole rod. Clear? So I'll consider, let a stripe of mass dm and thickness dx is located at distance x. Naturally, there is something which is interesting. I need to calculate, I have choose my variable. So my variable is what? X. Actually, as I move from the axis to the right or left, then what is changing? X is changing. If I go to the extreme on the right, then here x is how much of? Plus L by 2. And if I go on the extreme left, then x is equal to how much of? Minus L by 2. Keep this in mind. Clear? So what I'm saying, let a stripe of mass dm and thickness dx is located at distance x. So what I need to calculate, children? I need to calculate mass of the stripe. Clear? Now, this rod is having uniform distribution of mass. So I can calculate what? Mass of the stripe using linear mass density or mass of unit length. So I'll say here, mass of unit length will be m by l. Right? Now I'll say, therefore, mass of a stripe. Children, when mass is 1, when the length is 1, then what is the mass? M by L. Now mass of stripe is having what thickness here? Dx. So dm will be how much? M by L into dx. Very simple. Mass of unit length is m by L. So mass of length dx will be how much here? M by L into dx, and that's equal to dm. Therefore, moment of inertia of the rod, I is equal to, we did the formula, r square dm. And you very well know the limits. In fact, r is equal to what? X. And here x is plus L by 2, here x is how much of? Minus L by 2. So it will be x square into dm, right? And x will vary from what? Minus L by 2 to plus L by 2. Now I'm going to substitute the value of dm. So I becomes x square, dm is m by L into dx, minus L by 2 to plus L by 2. So if I solve, children, m by L is constant, is comes out x square dm minus L by 2 to plus L by 2. And you easily know the integration of x square is what? X cube by 3. So moment of inertia I becomes m by L. We have x cube by 3 minus L by 2 to plus L by 2. I take these 3 common and then I put x is equal to L by 2 and again I put what? Minus L by 2. So I becomes how much, children? M by 3 L. L by 2 whole cube minus minus L by 2 whole cube. Right? Now we simplify this. And then I becomes m by 3 L, L cube by 8 plus L cube by 8. Now if you simplify m by 3 L into 2 L cube by 8, so 4 L square So I is equal to how much you get? ML square by 4 is a 12. So here we derive children very easily. Moment of inertia of a rod about an axis passing through its what? Center, and perpendicular to its axis is ML square by 12. Clear? This is the first derivation. Now you can choose on axis will be fixed. Here you are now children. Moment of inertia of a rod about an axis passing through its what? Extremity. Meaning, suppose I have, this is the rod, I want to rotate about this axis like this. Initially I was rotating about this axis passing through the middle, now about what? This axis. Right? So this discussion will also be same. I will be equal to r square dm, which is here x square dm. Will be putting suitable limits. X here will be 0 and here will be what? L. Very easy. Only I need to put double of dm, and dm we already calculated earlier. Dm is m by L into dx. If I substitute this value here children, then I becomes x square into m by L into dx 0 to L. M by L comes out as common. So I becomes m by L x square dx 0 to L. Clear? And therefore I becomes m by L x cube by 3 0 to L. Clear? So we have I is equal to m by L children L cube by 3 minus 0. If we simplify, then I becomes ML square by 3. So we got here, you can see in the contrast that if I choose a rod here, then moment of inertia about an axis passing through center, that is ML square by 12. Clear? Which is nearly 0.85, let's say, ml square. And I about extremity is ml square by 0.33 ml square. So you can see that this moment of inertia is what? Less compared to moment of inertia about an extremity. This moment of inertia is about 25% of moment of inertia in this case. So if I ask you about which axis it is easy to rotate, then what will you say about an axis passing through the center, because moment of inertia in this case is what? Less. Clear? Now children, moment of inertia of each and every object has a fixed value about an axis passing through its what? Center. For example, if I have to calculate moment of inertia, you are going to see moment of inertia of various objects. Children, if somebody will ask you what is the moment of inertia of a sphere, he may state a solid sphere or a hollow sphere. You don't have to ask about which axis, because if he does not mention the axis, that means he is talking about moment of inertia of a sphere about an axis passing through its what? Center. Okay? So we have, remember, each and every object will depend, will have its own moment of inertia depending upon its what? Shape. Like we have moment of inertia of a sphere. So here you have written the moment of inertia. Moment of inertia of a solid sphere about an axis passing the center is 2 by 5 mr square, and a hollow sphere is 2 by 3 mr square. Then the moment of inertia of a rod which is derived about an axis passing through its center and passing the extremity, both the values are given. You can take a screenshot and learn. The moment of inertia of a ring about an axis passing through the center. If this is the ring, this is the axis. Or about is about diameter. You can see about diameter, it is less. So if you have a ring, it's easy to rotate about its diameter, then rotating about an axis which is passing through center and is perpendicular to its what? Plane. Then the moment of inertia about an axis which is parallel to its length, half mr square, but perpendicular to its length is m r square by 4 plus l square by 12. Similarly, each and every object has a fixed moment of inertia depending upon the choice of the axis, right? So go through all this. We have discussed this moment of inertia in this class. I'm sure you understood the concept. Go through this in detail. Okay? Thank you.